So the main point of posture is to have a straight spine, more or less. It helps us maintain an alert frame of mind, helps the breathing come very naturally and easily, and helps the energy flow through the body in a very free and natural way. And I'm going to give meditation instruction that is what we've all been doing anyhow, but it's also very appropriate to this particular reading, The Myth of Freedom, the very first few pages. So we start out by bringing our awareness into the present, into this very space. And we can have a very wide, open, easy awareness of this room, which includes anything and everything that presents itself to us. So whatever sights meet your gaze, whatever sounds come to your ears, the sound of my voice, the sound of Rochelle's footsteps, the bell, all of that, you just let it come and let it go, and your attention, your awareness is just right here, very easy, effortless, in the room. It's like a big, wide open space of easy, effortless awareness. And then in the middle of that, we become aware there's like a highlight. It's like a line drawn on a piece of paper. The piece of paper is your awareness of the room. And the line is your breath that's going out into the space of the room. So you are aware of your breath coming up through your abdomen, your chest. You're particularly aware of the sensation of the breath as it exits your nostrils. And then you see it, as it were, you imagine it. It's like a line going out into space, into the space of this room, just like a line drawn on a piece of paper or a line drawn on water. It goes out, and then it dissolves, which is what the breath does. It dissolves into the space of this room. And then you're just right here in the room with whatever presents itself to your six sense organs. I'm including the mind. So there are objects of sight, sound, smell, taste, the body, and mental objects, thoughts and emotions that come and go. And in the middle of all this open awareness, the breath comes up. It exits your nostrils. It goes out into the space. It can go out far. And then it dissolves. And then you're just right here in the space. And the breath comes up, and it goes out into the space, and it dissolves, and here you are. So let's just do that for a minute or two. So if you've been thinking, just come back. And your awareness is here, wide open, easy, relaxed in the space of this room, aware of forms and colors, sounds, bodily sensations. Probably don't have tastes or smell. And then there are mental events, thoughts and emotions, which come and go. And as I'm speaking, they diminish. And then when there is silence, they come back. And in the middle of all this open space, you become aware of the breath, which goes out like a line drawn on a piece of paper, where the paper is your open, wide awareness of this room. And the line is your breath, like a highlight being drawn on that wide piece of paper. And you're aware of both at the same time. You're aware of the paper and the line. This open space and your breath going out into it. It dissolves, and then there's just your awareness of this room and of everything in it. And then the breath goes out. It's like a highlight, like a line drawn on a piece of paper, like an oar going out into water. And then it dissolves, just as what the breath does. It dissolves in this space, and your awareness is right here in the room. And then the breath goes out, it dissolves, and here you are. And the breath goes out, it dissolves, and there's just this. And when you're aware of the breath, you're aware of it and this space 100%. Just you, 100% aware of this. So you don't even need a voice checking. There's just the line, this open space, and then the line dissolving. And then there's this. The breath goes out, it dissolves, and then there's this open awareness. Now when thoughts come up, you just see them. And there are two kinds. There are the little thoughts, which just go across your mental landscape like birds going across a sky. And they're gone, and you're aware of the breath going out, dissolving, and then there's just the space of this room. And then there are big thoughts, which take you away. And after some time, you realize that you've been thinking. And there's no problem with that. You just identify it as thinking. Let it go. And come back to your awareness of this space. And in fact, you can see these thoughts very vividly. You can see what your mind's patterns are. What you're particularly thinking about, obsessed with, if that's the case. Worried about. Looking forward to. You can see it in the quality and the stories that are embedded in these thoughts. And as soon as you're aware that you're thinking, then you're not anymore. And you let the thought go and come back to open awareness of this space with the breath going out, dissolving, and here you are. And the breath goes out, and it dissolves, and then there's just this open space full of sights, sounds, bodily sensations, and thoughts and emotions. So if you've been thinking, make note of that, observe it. Maybe even be interested in the content of your thought. Catalog it, kind of. And then let it go and come back to this open awareness in the present moment. The breath going out, dissolving, and then there's just this. The breath goes out, it dissolves, and there is this. Now sometimes as the breath is going out and dissolving, there's a voice that's checking. Am I doing it? How am I doing it? Am I doing it well? Am I doing it badly? Making comments. That's the watcher. And you can just let that go so that it's just the breath going out into this open space, dissolving, and the breath goes out. And it dissolves, and then there's just this. So look at what you've been thinking. Note it. Let it go. And be aware of the breath going out like a line drawn on a piece of paper. And it dissolves into the space. And then there's just the space of this room now, with everything in it. And the breath goes out. You can feel it as it exits your nostrils. It makes a line going out into the space. It dissolves. And there is this. So we could end.
Sorry, guys.
I'm on the downside of this cold. Any comments or questions about that
practice?
I've got a cough drop. Thank you. Yes, Michael.
I find sometimes that I get distracted by the imagery of the line and the paper. It seems like something busy.
Hmm. Hadn't heard that imagery before?
No.
Okay. Maybe you have something better to propose? Or a shamatha vipassana? You know, what we're doing is we're working with focus on something precise, the breath. It's like a handle. It pulls us back. But at the same time, there's vipassana. There's wide open awareness of the present moment. So the idea is, in this practice, is that the breath goes out like a highlight in the space, like a point of focus, like a line drawn on a piece of paper. But it dissolves. And as it goes out, your effort dissolves with it. That sense of me, the doer, the meditator, it just dissolves, and there's just this, which is where we are, you know, intellectually. We're just right here in the present moment.
Well, yeah, I was actually contemplating sharing that very same thing, because you have guided before using that line, and I am with the guided meditation and always, except for that line. And I too start getting this mental picture that isn't necessarily corresponding with what I'm experiencing. My breath feels more diffused, or so. Yeah, it's.
What are you experiencing?
My breath doesn't. It doesn't feel like it's coming out in that in a linear way. It just feels more undefined in a way. So.
Well, maybe you could just be aware of the sensation of the breath as it exits your nostrils, which is a real thing.
Exactly.
And then let it, once that's gone, you're just right here in the present. Would that work better?
That works.
Okay. Yeah. That's fine. Tim?
I grew up on Lake Erie, and I've always been most comfortable since then when I'm around water, which is why living in Manhattan is helpful to me. So the version of the line on water dissolving speaks powerfully to me, because the wake of a boat or skipping a stone or really anything marks the water, but then it just goes away in a way that's really organic and unforced. Whereas when I draw a line on paper, it normally stays there. So I like the water metaphor better.
I've thought of an ectus, what do they call it, ectus sketch?
Is it a sketch?
Huh?
Etch-a-sketch.
Etch a sketch. You draw the line and then lift it up and it goes away. Well, you know, I mean, you can do it, you know, the way Brandon is doing it, that's fine. It's when you imagine it going out, you're sort of doing a very early version of visualization practice, which comes along in the Vajrayana. You do a lot of visualization practice. But if you're imagining the line, the breath going out into the space, which in fact it does, right? But if you're trying to imagine it, then you're sort of doing a visualization practice of seeing something mentally. But the main point is that your attention is focused on something very narrow, and then that dissolves. And when that point dissolves, you see, your attention is, actually it isn't focused on that. Your attention is right here and in the room, wide. But there's a highlight. Trungpa Rinpoche called it 75-25, which is figurative. But what he meant by that was that 75% of our awareness is on the open space, and 25% is on the highlight of the breath as it goes out. And then it dissolves, and then you dissolve with it, and there's just this. It's like that sense of effort of me, the doer, dissolves with the breath, and there's just this. In fact, you can have that awareness of the breath and the space without any self-reference, and which is perfect. It's like you're giving your attention to the practice 100%. And when you do, I, the ego, isn't there. It's the same with the awareness of anything. So the idea really is just that the breath is sort of like is the 25% and the space is 75%. However you want to do it. This is called shamatha vipassana. We're combining two different practices into one. The idea of a focus and a wide awareness, both at the same time. Ultimately, we could let go of the breath altogether. and just do pure vipassana, which is open awareness meditation. And the only reason that we're not doing that is that it's good to get familiar with this other practice first, because you see, the breath helps us. It pulls us back out of thought. And when you, as soon as you start practicing wide open meditation, it's much easier to spend long periods of time lost in thoughts. But as long as the breath is keeps going, it's like a handle. I think of it as like one of those handles inside an automobile, you know, that you use to pull yourself up and out of the car sometimes. That we use the breath as a handle to pull us back out of our thoughts into the present moment. We become aware that we've lost track of it. And it's easier to lose track altogether when we just do wide open awareness without any attention to the breath. But that's a legitimate practice too. It's regarded as sort of the next step, is that we drop the breath and just be aware of this. Because that, in fact, is a very practical, then we're practicing on the cushion what we can do in daily life. As we walk down the street, we can bring our awareness back from thoughts to this open awareness of the space that we're in, whether it be Times Square or your apartment, you know, anything. Yes, Brandon.
Just curious if you could elaborate a little bit on the concept of awareness as it relates to meditation awareness versus being in Times Square. And when you're asking us to be aware and hear, is that more of a soft awareness? In other words, if our eyes are open, they're soft gaze, fixed, more or less. So, you know, the awareness is very gauzy in a way, if that makes any sense.
Well,
or,
you know, the best way to do it with your eyes when you're meditating is to have a completely natural gaze, just the way you're looking at me. You don't go swimmy. You don't sort of bear down. But you have a very natural, relaxed gaze. Ultimately, the awareness that you're working with in meditation, as you sit on the cushion and are aware of the space and the breath going out into it, is exactly the same as you would practice in Times Square. Because it's the core of our being. It's what we come back to. You know, the bird song kind of is come back. And what we're coming back to is what we already were. You don't have to manipulate it. You don't have to make it better in any way. You can't. Because it's already as good as it gets. It's our being, this fundamental. See, just like right now, you can be aware of me and what I'm saying without any effort. Unless your mind drifts and then you call yourself back, and we do that all the time. But when we're here in the present, it's effortless. And that's the best kind of awareness. So that's what we're practicing on the cushion. And it's what we practice in as we walk down the street.
Coming back to the natural state.
The natural state. In fact, she just used a piece of Dharma jargon. Coming back to the natural state. Sometimes they call it resting in the natural state. You'll see instructions. You're doing a complicated practice, a visualization or this, and then it says, now rest in the natural state. And everybody in this room is doing it right now, more or less. You know, we just come back. And then thoughts arise, you let them go, and you come back here. Michelle.
Because everything else we do is not really a natural state. It's not really relaxed. It's always filled with some tension, anxiety, fear, some emotional stuff. But when you're in your natural state, i.e. the state that the Buddha was in when he attained enlightenment, let's say, most natural, then you're at home in your natural state.
Yeah, home. And we leave home on all kinds of mental journeys. There are the stories that we tell ourselves. And those stories are always about a central character, I. And they are fraught, those stories, with pain, with hope and fear, with anxiety of all kinds. And the really that this path about, is about shifting our loyalty from those stories to the awareness that is always here in the present moment. And that's really, it's not an easy thing to do, because that voice that's I says, yeah, but, what about, you know, everything's going to fall apart if I stop worrying, basically. And it's a very different kind of world, maybe a different kind of set of values. Yes?
A disinclination to accept the present moment fully was a huge barrier to establishing a sitting meditation practice for me. So I kept judging and saying, oh, if I could just find the perfect place to sit, where it was quiet and there are no distractions or whatever, then my meditation practice could really get off the ground. And it turns out, as everybody except me until recently probably in the room knows, that the clicking of the heater, the ringing of the bell, the honking of a horn outside this room are an integral part of the present moment. And so, just like the thoughts that you spoke of, I need to acknowledge them and just let them go. Because they will. Every click only lasts that long, and every ambulance siren is passing by. But it was a huge problem for a long time, much more so than it would seem at first glance.
Well, you know, there are many, many people, the misconception that Trungpa Rinpoche addresses in the very beginning of the chapter that you were reading, and you'll all be reading if you follow along with Myth of Freedom, is that meditation is about achieving some kind of peace, some kind of heaven, some kind of, you know, calm state where we calm out all of our everything. And it's not. It's about being aware, of everything, including what arises inside you. See, when we're lost in dreams, we're not even aware we're dreaming. You know, half the time we're walking down the street daydreaming and we don't even know it. Especially when we get caught up in a really strong emotion, you know, somebody says something insulting to you and you have this, and you're just completely caught up in the story. That son of a gun, you're going to say that to me, No, whatever it might be. So it's really, this whole path is about waking up, coming back out of all those dreams.
If I were able to stop attaching to certain things and pushing other things away, I'm in the habit of doing that, as many other people are, that would be a place of peace. The cessation of attachment and aversion is peaceful, but not in the sense of emptiness.
Like attachment to what? Chocolate, you mean? Or sex?
Or just even letting my mind go to those things, not that I'm specifically experiencing them now, but looking forward to the next piece of chocolate or reflecting on the last really great sex, for example.
That's the issue, is the reflection, right? The thinking about. Because those are the daydreams that take us away from the present moment. The chocolate isn't a problem. Sex isn't a problem, you know. All those things are great. It's the constant getting lost in dreams about them.
Taking a vacation from right now to there.
Yes. Yes, that's the issue, you know, because when we do that, we're not here for our lives. You know, we could dream our whole lives away and be missing half of it, or seeing it through this veil of thought and just not be here for it. So what Trungpa Rinpoche talks about in the very beginning section of the first chapter of The Myth of Freedom, he's talking about the Hinayana path. The Hinayana path is the narrow path. It's also, he calls it the foundational path. It's usually Hinayana literally means lesser path. And that was kind of a slam that was invented by the people who came later and called themselves Mahayanists, which means greater path, greater vehicle. But he says, no, it's not the lesser path, it's the foundational path. And why is it foundational? It's because we're beginning to wake up and see what's going on in our minds, that we've been sleepwalking, you know, and that we've been giving all our loyalties to these neurotic, anxious, fear-laden dreams. And then we've been letting them run our lives, those dreams, those anxieties, those hopes and fears. In the Sadhana of Mahamudra, which we did here a while ago, right? There's a line, it says, the bandits of hope and fear have stolen my mind away. You know, those are the thoughts, those stories. And that's what the first part of that chapter is about. It's about beginning to become familiar with that. That's the narrow path. It's like we have to begin to see the difference between our sleepwalking, our daydreaming, and what it is to be awake. Then we can start to really work on ourselves. And then that leads very naturally into the second path, the Mahayana path, which is the open path. It accomplishes a number of things, this meditation that we're doing. One is that we begin to free ourselves from these terrible stories that really torture us, that make us depressed, that make us frightened. You know, we begin to realize that that's not me, that we could shift our loyalty to the real me, who doesn't even need a story because it's always here in the present. You know, Brandon with a beard and me without, and you know, you with a blue sweater and Rochelle all in red, and you know, all of this stuff. This is the real us right now. And then we have all these stories about me and you, and whether I like you or whether I don't like you, and you know, am I afraid of you, and I have this hope about you. That's all just stories. And we just let that go, and we begin to become much freer. And that's the beauty of the Hinayana, is that we're achieving freedom from the tyranny of these stories, the tyranny and the pain. And that opens up the world into what the Mahayana is, which is an enormous discovery of huge openness and delight, and that we can actually afford to not be worrying about our own survival, and then we can afford to be generous. And that's the Mahayana. And then the Vajrayana goes beyond that. There's this constant quality of the path as it opens up, as we become more and more rooted in the present. But it's very hard to give up those stories. And really, the real meaning, you know, people think renunciation means I'm going to give up money, or I'm going to go live like a monk or a nun, or I'm going to stop eating chocolate, or, you know, not have sex or whatever. Real renunciation is the difficulty of giving up those stories. It's really hard. A, because they're habitual and repetitive. And B, because they give life to this I, this guy back there, this I. Rinpoche called him the hitchhiker. You don't need him, him or her. He called him the hitchhiker. It's like, I always imagine it like a parrot with a Keystone Cop hat sitting on my shoulder, going, "Rock, that's good. Rock, that's bad. Rock, watch out for that one." Tim and then Rochelle.
I just wanted to say that I've heard renunciation also described as a reorienting of priorities, so that I don't need to give up everything in my everyday life to tread a more spiritual path. But I do need to make things like practice more important than some other things. So if I have a chance to go out for dinner with friends at the expense of a part of my practice that's important, I need to make the practice more important. And that was a glimmer of hope for me, because I'm attracted to extremes. Like, I'm going to give up nothing, or I'm going to give up everything. And that was something that made sense to me. That was a middle way, if you will, to go forward.
And that's really great to say. And to add to that, what makes it even more, what convinces you to do that even more, to give up going out with friends and practicing, or whatever it is you're giving up from renouncing, is when you begin to realize that what you're actually doing is reclaiming your life by doing it. You know, you're practicing as you sit on the cushion, you are familiarizing yourself with all the habitual ways that we leave, and you're switching your loyalty from them to the present moment to your life.
It doesn't mean I'll never have dinner with my friends again. It means I didn't sit today. Sitting is important. They're going to have to wait this time. But not, maybe not every time. Every present moment is new, as we know.
You can always order in.
What?
I said you can always order in.
You can always order in. Yeah.
Well, one thing about being working with yourself and not always going back to reference pointing yourself for every little thing is that I notice that it's kind of a preparatory for the Mahayana, is because when people talk to us, we can't really be there for them 100% because everything they're saying is somehow translated into a reference point about us. So we can't really actually relate to anyone or anything because we're always thinking about how it's affecting us.
And when we give up that, then
really
we become very curious.
Can really help someone, you can really be present, and not even help someone, because that's, you know, you don't know if you can ever really help anyone, but it's a real help to just be present and for someone. Like Rinpoche said, Trungpa Rinpoche used to say, I don't necessarily always agree with what my students say to me, but they know that I'm totally there for them, with them, in the moment, in my heart.
Did he say that?
Yes, he did. I hope so, anyway. I think he did. Anyway,
he could have said it anyhow.
because when you spoke to him, he was there with you 100%. It wasn't always referencing something he wanted from you or wanted you to do for him or what was it for him or whatever. It was just completely there with you, and it was very spacious. Anyway.
So if this idea of the open space with the line going out into it and dissolving, if I'm doing this in too complicated a way, would it be better if instead of describing it, I just said 75-25. 75% of your awareness is on the space, 25% is on the breath as it goes out and dissolves. You see, Trungpa Rinpoche emphasized the fact that you become the breath. Your awareness is so 100% on the breath that you become it. And as it goes out and it dissolves, the you dissolves too. And then there's just open space. That's another way of talking about it. So it'd be helpful if we came up with the best way of guiding this, teaching this for people. Yeah. Microphone.
Well, one way I think he described it was, it's an awareness practice, it's not a concentration practice, where it's like you're concentrating on a flame, you're concentrating on a photo. It's an awareness. So your allegiance is to placing your awareness on the out-breath, and it's like 25 or 40% of the awareness is on the out-breath, and the rest of the awareness is on the space that you're in. It's not a concentration practice where you're just focusing one purposely, you know, one-mindedly or whatever on a flame, or you close your eyes and you're visualizing an arrow or something. And you keep your eyes open specifically because you want to experience being in the present moment fully in your surroundings, whether it's a beautiful shrine room like this here at Nalanda Bodhi, or, you know, sitting in Penn Station waiting for a train, or the Port Authority, you know, with all the homeless people, everything. It's just still the same space and still the same awareness.
Gary.
I would just agree with that a little bit, in the sense that when you describe it as an awareness practice, and how you're placing your awareness versus a concentration, like I kind of, when I envision some of the line drawing on water or line on a paper, I actually tend to visualize that. And I'm sort of I do find myself kind of concentrating on the visualization of that, as opposed to just being aware of the breath, I guess, if that makes sense. I mean, it's not a really strong one, but I would agree that does draw me more into a visualization of something than an awareness of it.
Okay. Michael.
I find that the exposition and the description is really needed and is good, but in the midst of practice, it makes me feel busy to be engaged in the description. That's the part that is troublesome in my mind when I do it, is that I'm engaged in a description and sort of try and understand what you mean when you say the thing about the line in the paper, and then where's the paper, and things like that. And I think I just have a sort of a bias against guided per se, you know, and this was very lightly guided, but sometimes things can be very, very in the world, not necessarily in the Buddhist canon or within shamatha. Vipassana aren't necessarily, practices aren't necessarily guided so much, whereas in other practices they can be very, very detailed. And but those practices sort of depend upon a foundation of shamatha and vipassana and that simplicity. So when I work with people, I try to separate the description from the practice in a clear way, so that people, when they're practicing, aren't caught up in trying to remember the visualization or the words that were said, you know, but that they have something more direct to do, which is to feel the breath and, you know, that kind of thing. So I found that helpful, to sort of like really segregate it and just say, and I work with people who have, you know, real anxiety issues and things like that and obsessiveness. So you give them any little thing to obsess about, they'll be gone. You know, they're gone on it. Half an hour of meditation, quote unquote, is going to be about getting the line right, you know, and getting it. So I tend to be really clear, like, now is description. Description is over. Now is practice. Practice is the breath. Feel the breath. That's all, you know. And, you know, that doesn't necessarily work all that well either, because it's not so easy to segregate. But that's my approach to what, to the question you raised.
I find that when John repeats the description, it if I'm away, it brings me back. If I'm still here, there's no harm in it. But maybe everyone, again, in the room except me, probably has more experience with different formal ritual practice tricks. Mm-hmm. But maybe like a little bell at completely random moments would serve the same thing without the verbalization, so that if I was away and I heard the bell, I would come back. And if I'm not away and I heard the bell, there's no harm done. But then there's no verbal processing to do. Does that make sense?
Well, the thing is, what you want to do with a guided meditation is help people to understand the practice so that they can go home and do it and get something out of it without the guided taking place. So it's really instructional. You know, guided meditation is not meant to be the same thing as your home daily practice. It's like giving meditation instruction, really, and just helping people, you know, to understand what they're going to do when they're off alone. So, but to me, it's a work in progress, and I love the feedback. I'm always experimenting with how best to teach it, and to see what how people react. And what I'm hearing tonight is that too many words, you know, perhaps too much instruction. Keep it simpler. That it gets too complicated, perhaps. But the basic point, you know, that we're working with here, and it's really the introduction to this book, is that spirituality is not about achieving a heaven of any kind, including the heaven of awareness. It's about being awake for one's life in a completely realistic and freed up way. I guess freed up from the imprisonment, the tyranny of the stories that we tell ourselves. Rinpoche talked about how we have to use those stories by seeing them, because there are our past, there are our past coming to life, you know, they're embodied. There are particular stories, there are particular neuroses. And he called them, in that opening chapter, it echoed another book that he had written, that is his very first book. He called them manure. They're manure in your garden. You know, you take a look at all this stuff that arises in your mind, and it's fine. You know, it's like you see it, and you're not going to indulge in it. You know, but it's manure. It's fertilizing by becoming aware of it. If you don't become aware of it, it's not manure. And in fact, that's a reference to a chapter in his very first book, Meditation in Action. It was called The Manure of Experience on the Field of Bodhi, Field of Awake, right?
My favorite book.
Is it?
You
edited it? Huh? No. No, I didn't edit that. That was done in England with Kunga, I think. Yeah, must have been Kunga. Richard Arthur, who I hope will come and speak here one of these days. Well, we should end. I think we can end. This is a little early evening. Any other last comments, complaints? Let's just try meditating for like just a couple minutes more. We're very early. And this idea of maybe it's best to go back to, it was a very early teaching, 75-25. The idea of working with the breath is kind of just a highlight in the middle of our open awareness of this present moment. And it's very important that our thoughts are not enemies, but that they become objects of awareness and that we let them go when we're dreaming. So we'll just do this for a few more minutes. Ding. Okay. I'm going to dedicate the merit. Rochelle's going to hand out the chance. But this, Brandon does. Brandon needs a copy. By this merit, may all attain omniscience. May it defeat the enemy wrongdoing from the stormy waves of birth, old age, sickness, and death. From the ocean of samsara, may I free all beings. By the confidence of the golden sun of the great east, may the lotus garden of the Rigdon's wisdom bloom. May the dark ignorance of sentient beings be dispelled. May all beings enjoy profound, brilliant glory.